वेरी गुड इवनिंग स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट क्वेश्चन ऑन द टेम्प्रो मैंडिबुलर जॉइंट एंड दिस इज स्पेशली इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर द डेंटल साइंसेस. दैट मीन्स दोज स्टूडेंट्स हु आर अटेंडिंग दिस वीडियो ओके एंड आर फ्रॉम द डेंटल ब्रांच दे शुड अंडरस्टैंड दिस ओके टेम्प्रो मैंडिबुलर जॉइंट वेरी वेल. ओके, now the question is describe the temporomandibular joint under following heads, and heads are the classification of TM joint, then the articulating bones which will be the head of the mandible and the articular fossa of the temporal bone, then the capsule of the joint, articular disc, there is a presence of intra-articular disc which divides the joint into two, and we will discuss about the articular disc at the length, then the ligaments which are supporting to this joint and movements of the joint. I will speak very shortly about the movements of the joint, and the next video will be in the detail about each and every movement which is possible at the temporomandibular joint. Then we will talk about the nerve supply, blood supply, and lastly the applied anatomy of the temporomandibular joint. So in answer you can write like this to begin. Okay, the temporomandibular joint is present in the infratemporal fossa. Okay, so it is located in infratemporal fossa, and this joint is formed between the head. Head means the condyle, which is also sometimes called as the condyles of the mandible, and the other side, the other bone with in which this head or condyle fits is the mandibular fossa of the temporal bone. So this is a joint between temporal bone above and the mandible below, and all the movements which are possible in the lower jaw, they are ultimately due to this joint. That means this is the only joint in the skull which is showing the movement. Okay, so because it is a synovial joint, that means all the lower jaw, all the movements are lower jaw, they are because of this temporomandibular joint. That means this is the only mobile joint in the skull. Coming to the classification of this joint, what kind of the joint is this temporomandibular joint? Okay, now this temporomandibular joint, to begin with, the most important that it is a synovial type of the joint. It is a synovial joint, and as this joint is formed between head and condyle of mandible and mandibular fossa of temporal bone, it encloses a cavity between these two bones, and this cavity is lined by the synovial membrane, and that's why its classification is the synovial type of the joint. Now sometimes it is also classified as complex joint. Complex joint means because there is presence of an intra-articular disc, and this intra-articular disc divides this temporomandibular joint into two separate compartments, an upper compartment and a lower compartment. Thus it is also called as complex joint, because the movement taking place in the upper compartment and the lower compartment of the joints, they are different, as we will see in the next video. Okay, now functionally it is also classified as diarthrosis, which means there are free movements possible. It can produce many type of the movements. Okay, so free movements are there, that's why it is also called as diarthrosis. Let us come to the next point, and that is articulating bone and articular surfaces of the temporomandibular joint. Which are the articulating bone? As I said, that upper articular surface is the formed by the mandibular fossa. Okay, and mandibular fossa is present at the base of the skull in the temporal bone. Okay, temporal bone. So it is the mandibular fossa, and just in front of mandibular fossa there is presence of the articular tubercle, which is a bunk that is convexity, okay, directing downward, while the mandibular fossa is the concavity directing downward. So The upper articular surface present a mandibular fossa and an articular tubercle of the temporal bone. Let me show you with the help of the diagram this mandibular fossa. Let us see get it orientation. This is the mandibular fossa. This is the external acoustic meatus here. Then this is the mastoid process, the zygomatic arch. This is the root of the zygoma. This is that mandibular fossa is seen from lateral aspect, and this is that articular tubercle is here. Okay, so this is the posteriorly it is the mandibular fossa, and anteriorly it is the articular tubercle. So the surface is concavo convex when we trace it from behind forward. So this is the upper articulating surfaces formed by the temporal bone. Now the lower articular surface is head of the mandible. Okay, and if you see in this diagram, this is the coronoid process, this is the condylar process of mandibular, this is the mandibular notch, and then this is the head of the mandible or condylar process. And you can see that head of the mandible on the top is covered by the articular cartilage, which is fibrocartilaginous in nature. And as we are seeing it from the lateral side, you can see that this articulating surface of the mandible, head of the mandible or condylar process of mandible, is convex anteroposteriorly. It shows the convexity. But if you will see this head of the mandible from the front or the back side, okay, then this head of the mandible again shows the convexity. That means convexity is there in both the direction. If you see it from side head or if you see it from anterior or posterior aspect, there is a large convexity is seen on the head of the mandible. That's why this head of the mandible is called as the condylar process also. Okay, and this is also covered by the articular cartilage. Okay, it is cartilage. Thus the shape of the head of the mandible is elliptical. Okay, that means it is convex transversely. Okay, it is convex transversely as well as convex anteroposteriorly. See this, anteroposteriorly and convex transversely. That's why it is called as elliptical shape of this. Let us come to the articular surfaces of both the bones are covered by fibrocartilage. Just remember here at this stage that in the most of the synovial joint, the ends of the articulating bones are covered by the hyaline cartilage. Okay, now this is the temporomandibular joint where the articulating bone, both the head of the mandible as well as the mandibular fossa and articular tubercle of the temporal bone, they are covered by fibrocartilage. That thing you should always remember. Okay, don't say that it is also covered by the hyaline cartilage like any other synovial joint. Okay, that will be wrong. After this articulating bone, let us come to the next point, and that is articular capsule of the joint. What is articular capsule? It is a fibrous membrane made up of the collagen fibers. So it is inelastic and it tightly surrounds the articulating bone, upper articulating bone as well as the lower articulating bone, completely like a sleeve. It surrounds like a sleeve. Okay, there is no opening. It is completely a close, sleeve, where it encloses a cavity, and that cavity is called as the synovial cavity, okay, or the joint cavity to begin with. Okay, it is joint cavity. Now if you see this cavity, okay, articular capsule of the joint, you will see that in this diagram you can see where is the attachment of the capsule. In the dark green I have shown you this capsule. Okay, this is the upper, let me tell you about this area. This is the mastoid process, this is the external acoustic meatus, and this is the tympanic membrane. And then This is the mandibular fossa, which is concave downward, and this is the junction between the mandibular articular fossa and that of the tympanic membrane, where a fissure is seen, what is called as the its name is the this between the tympanic and that of the temporal. So this is the temporotympanic fissure. Okay, temporotympanic fissure is there. Okay, and this is the demarcation. That means beyond this fissure is the this non-articular tympanic membrane. Plate is there, and in front of this is the mandibular fossa. Now, what you will see here, I was telling you about this articular capsule, and this is shown in the dark green color. There is the attachment of the fibrous articular capsule. Let us see, it's the upper attachment, okay, upper attachment. Above, it is attached in front of the articular tubercle. This is that bump, okay, with convexity downward. Just in front of the articular tubercle, there is the attachment of this fibrous membrane, okay, in front. And posteriorly, it is attached to the squamotympanic fissure. I was forgetting that name, squamotympanic fissure. Okay, between the squamous part of the temporal bone and the tympanic plate, there is a fissure, squamotympanic fissure. And to this, posteriorly, this capsule is attached to the squamotympanic fissure. And on medial and lateral side, it is attached to the margin of the mandibular fossa. This is the mandibular fossa, and then on the lateral side and medial side, it is attached to this mandibular fossa. If you will see, just by turning the the base of the skull, where the mandibular fossa and articular tubercle are present, you will see that this is an oval area. This is so on to the medial and lateral side of this oval area, this capsule is attached above. So this anteriorly in front of the articular tubercle, posteriorly in the squamotympanic fissure, and median and laterally to the margin of the mandibular fossa is the upper attachment of this articular capsule. Okay. Below, now you trace this below, this articular capsule, which is a fibrous membrane, below is attached surrounding to the neck of the mandible. It is attached to the neck of the mandible. Okay, so this is surrounding to the neck of the mandible. Easy attachment is here. Okay, and thus it is upper and the lower attachment of the fibrous capsule, and this will enclose a cavity called as the joint cavity of TM joint. Okay. And this joint cavity of TM joint will be divided into two compartment, an upper and the lower compartment of joint. See, this is the this disc, intra-articular disc, and this is dividing the joint cavity into an upper compartment and this joint cavity into the lower compartment, and this is because of the articular disc. So now we come to the description of this intra-articular disc of the TM joint. Now this intra-articular disc of the TM joint, okay, is an oval. As I said, that the temporal articular surface is also oval. So if you will see from above or below, the whole circumference of this disc, it is oval in shape, though here is a section, so don't confuse, it is having an oval circumference. So this is oval fibrocartilaginous disc, okay, which is present within the joint. So it is called as intra-articular disc. Now this divides the joint cavity in two compartment, upper and lower, which I have already explained you. Now the upper surface of this disc, see very carefully, the upper surface of this disc is concavo-convex. The upper surface is concavo convex. If you see, trace it from anterior to posterior, then the upper surface of this disc first is concave upward and then it is convex upward. So it is concavo convex, convex directed upward. That is the upper surface. Okay. And if you will see the lower surface of this disc, then it is concave downward. It is concave downward. Now, disc is here. Now, this is a something very important, just to tell the disc surfaces, because the movements will depend on this shape. Movements of the joint will depend on this shape. Now, the upper surface, I have said, as the of the disc is concavo convex, okay, in the upper surface it is concavo. So because of this shape, concavo convex shape, the disc will fit very closely with that of the mandibular fossa, articular tubercle and because the articular tubercle, if you trace it from anterior to posterior, it is articular tubercle as well as articular fossa. If you trace it anterior to posterior, it is to begin with convex downward and concave upward, and this is closely going to fit with the upper surface of the articular disc, which is just opposite to the convexity of the articular tubercle. That's why it is concave upward. Okay, and here, since the articular fossa is concave downward, here the articular disc is convex upward. So you can see the shape of the articulating bone, that is the articular fossa and articular tubercle, okay, will closely fit with the upper surface of the intra-articular disc. Okay, and if you see the inferior surface of this disc, okay, this disc is concave. See in this diagram, this disc is completely concave. Okay, it is concave on its inferior surface. And why it is concave on its inferior surface? Because the head of the mandible is convex. Head of the mandible. So this inferior surface will completely fit to the convexity of the head of the mandible. Okay, head of the. Now let us see another aspect, how it is possible that its upper surface is concave convex, okay, and lower surface is only concave. This is possible because of the shape of this intra-articular disc. Okay, because if you will trace the anterior margin of this intra-articular disc and adjoining capsule here, this gives attachment to the this two limbs of this intra-articular disc. One of the limb will go upward and fuse with the inner surface of capsule, while the lower limb of this inferior intra-articular disc will go downward and then will fuse with the capsule. There will be a gap between the capsule and the anterior margin of this intra-articular, which is occupied by the fibrofatty tissue. Okay, so the spatial shape of this intra-articular disc, okay, is, I mean to say, giving the two different shapes to the upper compartment and to that of the lower compartment, okay, of the joint, okay, to that of the joint. Anterior and posterior compartment of to the joint is there, right? Okay, so you have seen the disc, okay, you have seen. Now, let us see something different here. Now, this is the anterior margin or anterior surface of the articular capsule, to which the anterior edge of the intra-articular disc is attached. And you should remember that when we were learning in the last video about the attachment of the lateral pterygoid muscle, the upper head was attached to the anterior surface of the articular capsule, and through this capsule it was also attached to the anterior margin of the articular disc. Okay, so this surface of the articular capsule is attached to the lateral pterygoid muscle. Okay, lateral pterygoid muscle. I hope you have understood this joint cavity. Okay, let us come to the within this joint cavity, where is the synovial membrane? And the synovial membrane is intracapsular lining to all those parts of the joint which are non-articular part. Okay, though they are intracapsular, but non-articular part. I will use the red color, okay, red color pencil to draw this synovial membrane. Now see, this synovial membrane will cover to the undersurface of the articular capsule everywhere. Okay, just remember that this is in the form of a sleeve surrounding all around, completely circumferentially it is surrounding the articular. So all the part of the articular capsule will be covered by the synovial membrane. Okay, the disc is not covered by the synovial membrane. Okay, and here the articular margin, that is which is covered by the articular cartilage, that is fibrocartilage, this synovial membrane will go right up to the margin of articular cartilage. It will not cover to the articular cartilage in the fossa and tubercle above, as well as that part of the neck of the mandible which is non-articular, which is not covered by the articular cartilage, it will also be covered by the synovial membrane. See here, the neck is non-articular part of the neck, and then the capsule, they are covered by the synovial membrane, except the parts of the cartilage, okay, intra-articular cartilage, both superior and inferior surface, as well as the articular fossa and the articular tubercle of the temporal bone, and then ischemus part of temporal, and then the articular cartilage covering to that of the head of the mandible, they will be not covered. Otherwise, everything which is non-articular will be covered by the synovial. Why this disc is not covered by the synovial membrane? Reason being that it is articular in nature, because the articular cartilage of the head, okay, will fit into the concavity of the inner inferior surface, and the concavo convexity of the disc will fit into the articular cartilage of that of the ischemus temporal bone of the articular fossa and articular tubercle. I hope you have understood the intra-articular disc. Let us come to another aspect, and that is the ligament. Okay, now the ligaments of this joint, they are of two types: a true ligament and an accessory ligament. A true ligament is nothing but the thickening of the articular capsule, which we have learned that it is made up of the fibrous membrane, and to this fibrous membrane, if thickening takes place, that will be called as the true ligament. Now, and then other kind of the ligaments, they are called as accessory ligament. But these accessory ligaments, they are away from the joint, that is away from the articular capsule, okay, and they provide the stability to the joint, or the firmness to the joint, okay, by their attachment to the two articulating bone. Above it was the bone which was temporal bone, ischemus part of temporal, and below it is that of the mandible. Okay, so though they are away from the joint, but they are giving stability or strength to the joint, prevents their dislocation. This is more important accessory ligament, because here there is only one true ligament of the temporomandibular joint. Let us see first the true ligament of the temporomandibular joint. Just see, external acoustic meatus, the mastoid process, the tympanic plate, the zygomatic arch. This is the root of the zygoma, where it will divide into anterior root and the posterior root, and this is the articular tubercle lateral surface. So this true ligament is of the TM joint is the lateral ligament of TM joint. This is also known as lateral ligament. I will just give you the name lateral ligament. Ligament of the, it is a true ligament of TM joint. And as I said that it is the thickening of the articular capsule on the lateral aspect of the joint. Okay, on the lateral aspect of the joint. Above this is attached to the root of zygoma, which I said the root will divide into posterior and anterior root. Root of zygoma just in onto the lateral surface of the articular tubercle. Okay, and below this is attached here to that of the lateral surface of the neck. Okay, it is attached to the lateral surface of the neck of the mandible. Okay, and in this fibers are running downwards and backward because this is anterior side and this mastoid process is posterior side. So these fibers are running downwards and that of the backward. This is two ligament. Let us see the accessory ligament. There are two accessory ligament. One starts from the sphenoid process. Okay, it is starting from the sphenoid process and going to the lingula of the mandible, which is a bony projection for attachment of this sphenomandibular ligament, which is covering to a opening of the mandibular foramina through which the inferior alveolar vessels and the nerve is passing to the mandibular canal. Okay, so from sphenoid, the process or the spine of the sphenoid as it is called as, then it goes up to this on the medial aspect of the ramus of mandibular, just superficial to the mandibular foramina. This is a bony process to which it is attached. So this is the sphenomandibular ligament. Let us see that this is quite away from the joint capsule and the joint itself. Okay. And this runs from medial to lateral side, okay, which cannot be shown in this diagram. Another accessory ligament is from the styloid process to that of the angle of the mandible. That is called as the stylomandibular ligament. It is called as the stylo. So these are the strong fibrous bands, these two ligaments, and they are accessory ligament to the joint, situated away from the joint itself. But they provide the stability because we have seen that this lateral ligament is the only single ligament of the temporomandibular joint. Let us come to the movements of this joint, okay? And for movements of this joint, I will show you the three different diagrams and will tell you the different movements of the joint, okay? Just I will name them, and as I said that, the next video will be only on the movements of the temporomandibular joint because they are very important. They are very. Here you just remember the different movements which are possible on the tempro. In that video, I will tell you how the mechanism of this movement takes place because of the contraction of the different muscles. Okay. Now, the first movement is protraction. Protraction means the forward movement of the jaw. Forward, okay? That means jaw protrudes forward. Then retraction means it is brought back to the normal position, and it is because of the retraction movement, okay? And this is the backward movement, okay? When the head of the mandible comes back into the mandibular fossa. Then depression. Depression means opening out of the mouth. Why it is called depression? Because the chin depresses down. Okay, because of the rotation of the mandible, head of the mandible in the mandibular fossa. See this. This is the close position. I mean to say, where the mouth is closed. Close position means mouth. Here the head of the mandible is completely inside the mandibular fossa on the inferior surface of the articular disc, okay? Intra-articular disc. See this? And here the concavity of the inferior surface of the articular disc is closely fitting with the convexity of the head of the mandible. It takes place usually in the when we have the our mouth closed. Then this is the depression when takes place, then the head of the mandible will start rotating forward. Okay, it is rotating forward, and this is the opening of the mouth in the depression. What I was saying that the chin will go down. See the direction of the head and neck of the mandible. Here it is vertical, here it is running downwards and backward. That means the chin is going downward. That's why this neck is going backward and ramus will go backward. So this is the depression or the opening of the mouth in slightly opening. But when you have to open the mouth in large opening, when you want to take a big bite on the apple, then you open your mouth to the largest, okay, widest, I mean to say. And in the wide opening, what happens that the head of the mandible goes I mean to say down below the articular tubercle with other movements of the intra-articular disc, which I will explain you in the next video. Okay, so this is the wide opening. Here you are seeing that the head is moving, I mean say on the undersurface of the articular tubercle. Then there is a movement what is called as the elevation. Elevation is closer. When the reverse movement will take place, then it will be the closer of the mouth. And lastly, it is the chewing movement, because it is side to side grinding movement when we chew our food. That takes place between maxillary and mandibular teeth. So food is grind. So these are the different movements of the temporomandibular joint. And lastly, I come here to that of the nose supply, and all those nose and blood vessels which are close to that of the TM joint, they are responsible for the blood and nose supply. For example, auriculotemporal nerve, just very close to the joint it is going, okay. Deep temporal nerve are there in front of the joint, and mesenteric nerve. All three are sensory nerve, branches from the mandibular nerve, and they supply the capsule of the joint and to the ligaments of the joint, right? So they are sensory nerves. Blood supply is from the vessels which are very close to the neck of the mandible, the superficial temporal and maxillary artery. Both the arteries are terminal branches of the external carotid artery, which divide just behind the neck of the mandible. And both these arteries, superficial temporal, which is going upward, and maxillary artery, which is going forward deep to the neck of the mandible to the infratemporal fossa, they will send minute branches to the joint. Now lastly, the applied importance. Now applied importance is in relation to the detachment of the articular disc. Sometime due to the injury, okay, or excessive pressure, this joint, the intra-articular disc may get injured, okay. It may injure, or it may rupture from the capsule, because it is attached on its circumference to that of the articular capsule, inner aspect of the, and this may show the rupture, and then the disc may get displaced from its original core. So it will interfere with the various movements of the TM joint. And while movements are taking place, there will be a clicking sound because of the articular disc, okay, irregular surface coming between the two articulating bones. So there will be a clicking sound, and definitely there will be pain during the movements of the jaw, because articular capsule is supplied by the sensory nerve, as we have seen. Okay, so because rupture of this disc from the capsule will cause the pain during the movement especially. Now the second applied importance is in dislocation of mandible. Some of you must have suffered the dislocation of mandible, and in this condition there is a wide opening of the mouth, and that means you cannot close your lower jaw. That means your mouth cannot, the jaw cannot be brought back to the close position of mouth, and it always remains wide open, okay, open wide, and no movement takes place in this position. This is because of the dislocation of mandible. Here what happens, that the head of the mandible, okay, in wide opening, as I have shown you in that diagram here, where the wide opening was there. Here this, let us see this diagram. In this, the head of the mandible comes under the surface of the, it comes under the surface of the articular tubercle, but this leads to wide opening. But if suppose there is an excessive wide opening taken place, all of a sudden this head, what it will do, it will slip in front of the articular capsule, articular tubercle. Here the head will come to lie here, so that it cannot go back, because there is a bump here of the articular tubercle, which is preventing the head to go back into the articular fossa here into. So during the closure, okay, when we try to, it is remain here, it will remain here, head will remain here in front of the articular tubercle, and that is the because of the wide opening of the mouth, the there will be dislocation will be. Then how to reduce this, okay? It is simple. When a patient will come, you can put your both the thumbs of right and left hand, okay, on the last molar, tooth and then just press it downward, and then at the same time give the chin a thrust backward. So by pressing the last molar tooth downward, you are bringing the head of the mandible on the inferior surface of the articular tubercle, and by giving a pressure, okay, or just giving a thrust of thrust to that of the chin to go backward, the head will be going in the articular fossa, and that way easily you can reduce this dislocation of the jaw, and person will be able to move his jaw now properly. This completes a very important question on to the temporomandibular joint, and we have covered almost all the areas: classification, articulating bones, capsule of the joint, articular disc, and then synovial membrane, ligaments, movement, nerve supply, and applied anatomy. Thank you very much for watching this video.